Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. Are you looking for a great website that gives you history the way it was intended to be told, with no PC, no Marxism, no progressivism? Well, I've got it for you. It's learntruehistory.com. That's learntruehistory.com. Learn history from great professors who don't sugarcoat it for you. This is not for your delicate flowers. That's learntruehistory.com. learntruehistory.com. This is the Brion McClanahan Show. 3, 2, 1, 0. Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. This is episode 14. So, I was in the Walmart the other day, and at the checkout line there, and looking at the end where they have all the magazines, which are usually pretty awful, but there was this one particular magazine that caught my eye, and so I picked it up, and the title of the magazine was American Presidents, the Greatest and the Worst, All Presidents Ranked, the Good, the Bad, and the Forgettable. And so this particular magazine is published, I thought it might have been published by Time or something of that nature, but it's not published by one of those companies. It was created just for this. It's Harris Classics is the publisher, Harris Publications. And so what they did is they went out and they took surveys, just like this normally happens, and they looked at all the different surveys that have been taken over the years, really beginning with the Schlesinger survey back in 1948. And then added other surveys. And so they ranked all of these presidents. All 44, actually there's 43 presidents, 44 administrations, 43 presidents. And on the back of the magazine, it has the oath of office. And that piqued my interest because, of course, that's how I rank the presidents in my book, 9 Presidents Who Screwed Up America and 4 Who Tried to Save Her. So I thought, well, they got the oath on the back, so obviously they're at least interested in that. Of course they're not, because they're using the presidential rankings from historians, so those are always all messed up. But I go to the back, and I know what I'm going to find there. And of course I find people who actually defended their oath in the back and in the least of the rankings. So, in fact, this is the chapter titled Feet of Clay. That was Tom DiLorenzo's, I think, one point. He was looking into something, a book on Henry Clay called Feet of Clay. So, pretty funny. But, of course, these are the people you would expect to find in a worst list of presidents. So, coming in last, of course, is Andrew Johnson. And then, James Buchanan. And then you've got Warren Harding. You've got Andrew Johnson, 39th. Pierce, 38th. Millard Fillmore, 37th. And then John Tyler, 36th. Now, I've already talked about Andrew Johnson on this podcast and how he is vastly underrated. How Andrew Johnson should actually be considered one of the best presidents in American history, not the worst. And I don't really believe that had Lincoln survived, if he wasn't assassinated in April of 1865, I don't really believe he would be ranked as highly as he is today, or he would have been as successful as people think he would have been. I think that's the better way to look at it. He probably would have been ranked highly, but Lincoln would not have been able to navigate Reconstruction any better than Andrew Johnson. I don't believe he would, because he still would have had the same rascals in Congress. He was still dedicated to a program of Reconstruction that the radicals in Congress did not want. I say rascals, they're radicals, or as James Byard called them, reptiles. So I don't think that Lincoln would have been able to do anything different than Andrew Johnson. He would have vetoed legislation, the Republicans would have overridden his veto, and they would have gotten what they wanted anyways. Lincoln had more political capital, but I'm not certain that he would have been any more successful. So I've already talked about Johnson, but the one I want to talk about in this list, and I'm going to read you the little blurb that they wrote about him, is the man that I consider to be the greatest president in American history, and that's John Tyler. Now, if you really want to know what I think about who are the 10 best and 10 worst presidents, You can find this for free right now. There's actually a my class on this is out there for free. Just look up Tom Wood's 10 Best and 10 Worst Presidents. Or you can go to learntruehistory.com and you can get my classes on the Constitution, U.S. history, of course, also this class. But you can get some other goodies out there, plus great classes on economics, philosophy, logic. So it's a wonderful course, website, learntruehistory.com. I've linked to it on the bottom of this podcast. Just click that, go over to that, or you can look up Tom Wood's 10 Best and 10 Worst, and the class will be out there for you for free. I think you have to use the code word executive to get the class for free, but right now it's free. So I'm going to focus on John Tyler, and I'm going to read you this little thing here that they wrote in this magazine. Number 36, John Tyler. His accidency, as Tyler was known, eventually alienated almost everyone. Let's begin with the positives. John Tyler became the first man to marry while in the White House after his first wife, Letitia, died in 1842, and he married the fashionable Julia Gardner, 30 years his younger, in 1844. As a father of 15 children, 8 with his first wife, 7 with his second, Tyler remains the most prolific president in American history. By ascending to the presidency after the death of William Henry Harrison just 1 month into Harrison's first term, Tyler established the precedent of vice presidential succession in the event of the president's death. His opponents like to refer to him as his accidency. Alas, beyond this modest list of achievements, most of which were hardly the result of his efforts, Tyler was an abysmal failure, frequently displaying stunningly poor political instincts. While elected on the Whig ticket, Tyler was really a states' rights man, and when he vetoed legislation to create what many felt was a vitally needed national bank, his entire cabinet resigned on him, his party disowned him, and a movement in Congress to impeach him gained steam. It did not succeed. By the end of his single term, he was hated by pretty much everyone on both sides of the aisle, making a run for a re-election in 1844 a near impossibility. In 1861, he would be elected by the secessionist state of Virginia as a member of the Confederate House of Representatives, making him the only president guilty of treason. He would die before he could take office. There are so many problems with this little piece, I don't even know where to begin. All right, so let's just start with the top. So they're going to rank this man. His achievements are getting married in the White House and having 2 wives and 15 children. Are you serious? That's what you're going to list in a ranking of presidents as the achievements of the president. And ascending to the White House after the death of William Henry Harrison. That's an achievement. So why rank him higher than last? I mean, what you've just talked about there has nothing to do with anything that he did in office. This is how stupid this ranking is. It's illogical. Really. I mean, if you're going to rank these people based on what happened in office, I mean, why would he be not lower than Andrew Johnson? I mean, Andrew Johnson at least, you know, supposedly did something, or Millard Fillmore, or even Franklin Pierce. Why not rank him lower than them? Because obviously he's a traitor. He's guilty of treason. Well, if that's the case, this man shouldn't even be on the list. He's a traitor. He committed treason. So first of all, that first paragraph is just so stupid. It's fluff. It's indicative of what the modern historical profession thinks about anything, which is nothing. And I'm going to do a podcast at some point on how academic history is dead. But this is indicative of academic history. Historians, let's see what John Tyler did. He had 2 wives and 15 children. That makes him prolific. Yeah, this guy's great. Yeah, high five. Yeah. Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's good. Hey, you just get a sitting in a seminar talking about John Tyler. that's good. That's really that's brilliant. Brilliant, you came up with that there. I'm glad you got your PhD in history and coming up with that one. And so then you have the accomplishments outweighed by, those were his accomplishments, outweighed by his negatives. So His negatives. He was elected on the Whig ticket, but Tyler was really a states' rights man. All right, so this actually shows no understanding of the Whig Party. Let's look at that statement and just tear that one apart for a minute. He's elected on the Whig ticket, but he's actually a states' rights man. I don't know if these people realize it, but the term Whig was actually floated around in South Carolina first when Andrew Jackson was being rather obnoxious towards the state during the nullification crisis. In fact, they started calling him King Andrew and basically saying he's a Tory. And so anyone who opposed King Andrew was a Whig. And for years... for years, South Carolina ran their own candidate for president. And they called him a Whig. And they were Whigs in the truest sense. They were opposed to the king. And John Tyler was the only man in the Senate to speak against the force bill because he said it was unconstitutional. You see, what the Whigs wanted to do, why they nominated John Tyler, was because they wanted to court the states' rights anti-Jackson men. And it worked because they got a lot of votes in the South because of John Tyler. John Tyler had always been a states' rights man, and part of the Whig Party were states' rights men. One thing I can say positively about the Whig Party, even Henry Clay, who I don't really like, he made a case that he was actually an old Jeffersonian Republican. And in fact, Michael Holt's book on the Whig Party, it's about a 18 million page book on the Whig Party. He points out at the beginning that the Whig Party, in so many ways, they weren't Federalists. They weren't, they weren't Federalists. They were National Republicans. And they were Republicans. I mean, even if you look at some of the Whigs, I mean, they were very much against executive power. Even Henry Clay was really against executive power. He just favored a legislative program that was unconstitutional. But he could say that, Thomas Jefferson favored this too in his second term, and he was kind of correct about that. I mean, look, Jefferson and Madison were pushing an embargo that a lot of Republicans said was unconstitutional. So Tyler was not, he was a Whig. And so to say that he was not really a Whig, he's a states' rights guy, this just shows historical ignorance. And of course, this is supposedly written by a group of great historians. And when he vetoed legislation to create what many felt was a vitally needed national bank, his entire cabinet resigned on him, his party disowned him, and a movement in Congress to impeach him gained steam. All right, I'll talk about that in a second. But let's look at this issue of guilty of treason. Now, that word is being used a lot recently because of the politically correct purge of anything associated with the South from the 1861 to 1865 period. And of course, anyone who supported the South at that time is a traitor, is a committed treason. They don't understand the definition of the term. In fact, if you look up in the Constitution what it says treason, what constitutes treason, it's not what the South did. In fact, you could make a case it's what Abraham Lincoln did, because treason is defined as waging war against them, meaning the states. And Lincoln sent in the army and waged war against them, particularly if you follow Lincoln's constitutional logic that the states were actually not out of the Union. They hadn't officially seceded. It wasn't de facto or de jure. It was neither. So he's sending troops into states that are still technically part of the Union without the authorization of either the state legislatures or the governor. That, by very definition, is treason. John Tyler did not commit treason. And if you follow this logic, and I think these people don't understand what they're saying, then George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, Alexander Hamilton, James Monroe, Benjamin Franklin. I mean, take your pick of the big names, John Adams from the founding generation, Sam Adams, John Hancock, any of those guys. They're all traitors. But we wouldn't call them that because they're supporting our side. So this is how stupid this is. All right, so let's look at John Tyler's presidency, because I think it's important to understand what John Tyler actually did. Yes, he was the first president to assume the office after a death of a president, which did set up presidential succession, because nobody really knew how this would work. In fact, the cabinet would call John Tyler into a meeting and say, look, John, we understand that you're the vice president, but what's going to happen is we're going to run the show, and you're just going to rubber stamp whatever we do. And so John Tyler famously told him, take a hike. Here's what he said. I beg your pardon, gentlemen. I am very glad to have in my cabinet such able statesmen as you have proved yourselves to be, and I shall be pleased to avail myself of your counsel and advice. But I can never consent to being dictated to as to what I shall or shall not do. I, as president, shall be responsible for my administration. I hope to have your hearty cooperation in carrying out its measures. So long as you see fit to do this, I shall be glad to have you with me. When you think otherwise, your resignations will be accepted. His cabinet resigned because of some of the things he did, but they were already putting pressure on him in 1841 to run the show, and Tyler said, no, I'm going to do what I was essentially elected to do, which is run the executive branch. And Henry Clay famously came up to the executive mansion, before it was called the White House, came up to the executive mansion at one point. Of course, he's down in Congress in the trenches, and he was furious with John Tyler because John Tyler was not doing what they wanted him to do. He was blocking their legislation. And so, apparently, Tyler stood up, put a finger in Henry Clay's face, and said this, then, sir, I wish you to understand this, that you and I were born in the same district, that we have fed upon the same food and breathed the same natal air. Go you now, then, Mr. Clay, to your end of the avenue where stands the Capitol, and there perform your duty to the country as you shall think proper. So help me God, I shall do mine at this end of it as I think proper. And these two men never spoke again. John Tyler basically told him to shove it. Go back down the Capitol where you belong, Clay, and you get out of the executive mansion, which you can't get in, and I'll do what I have to do here. That alone makes John Tyler a great president. So, he does veto a bank bill. He does it twice. And that's when the Whigs kick him out of the party, and his cabinet resigns. As the piece said, in fact, they don't just kick him out of the party. They have this big meeting on the steps of the Capitol, and they formally boot him from the Whig party. Great. Who wants to be a part of that den of thieves anyways? At that point. Now, here's the interesting thing about this. All of the impeachment proceedings were actually begun, or at least the legislation, by a man named John Minor Botts. And John Minor Botts was a friend of John Tyler's, and supposedly John Tyler told him when they were bunking together one time that he favored a Bank of the United States. And so Botts starts writing this legislation, then Tyler vetoes it all. And so Botts is furious, and he actually starts looking to impeach John Tyler because he's abusing executive power by issuing vetoes. I mean, this is how stupid this is. Right? The president can't veto legislation? Let me explain to you. I'm going to read to you why John Tyler vetoed this bank legislation. And it should have people standing up and cheering. John Tyler should be put to, like, number one. I think he's the best president in American history, according to his oath. I mean, you can make a case that, you know, George Washington should be up there. But John Tyler should be in that top two. So here's what he says in his veto message. The power of Congress to create a national bank to operate per se over the Union has been a question of dispute from the origin of the government. And my own opinion has been uniformly proclaimed to be against the exercise of any such power by this government. Tyler then pointed out that his oath to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution prohibited him from signing a bill containing provisions he had long deemed to be unconstitutional. Should he change course at this time, Tyler insisted, he would surrender, quote, all claim to the respect of honorable men, all confidence on the part of the people, all self-respect, all regard for moral and religious obligations, without an observance of which no government can be prosperous and no people can be happy. It would be to commit a crime which I would not willingly commit to gain any earthly reward, and which would justly subject me to the ridicule and scorn of all virtuous men. Imagine a president saying that today. And then when he vetoed the bank a second time, he said this, quote, I readily admit that whilst the qualified veto with which the chief magistrate is invested should be regarded and was intended by the wise men who made it a part of the Constitution as a great conservative principle of our system, without the exercise of which, on important occasions, a mere representative majority might urge the government in its legislation beyond the limits fixed by its framers, or might exert its just powers too hastily or too oppressively. Yet it is a power which ought to be most cautiously exerted, and perhaps never except in a case eminently involving the public interest, or one in which the oath of the president, acting under his convictions, both mental and moral, imperiously requires its exercise. So in other words, he's saying the president shouldn't veto legislation unless it's unconstitutional. In such a case, he has no alternative. He must either exert the negative power entrusted to him by the Constitution chiefly for its own preservation, protection, and defense, or commit an act of gross moral turpitude. Mere regard to the will of a majority must not, in a constitutional republic like ours, control this sacred and solemn duty of a sworn officer. The veto must be exerted against the will of a mere representative majority or not at all. It is alone in pursuance of that will that any measure can reach the president. And to say that because a majority in Congress have passed a bill, he should therefore sanction it, is to abrogate the power altogether and to render its insertion in the Constitution a work of absolute superiorization. The duty is to guard the fundamental will of the people themselves from, in this case I admit, unintentionally, change or infraction by a majority in Congress. In that light alone do I regard the constitutional duty which I now most reluctantly discharge. So, the president, he said, shouldn't veto legislation unless it's unconstitutional. And he's realizing this is against the will of the majority, but it's necessary to preserve the Constitution. Now, I don't think I've read a veto message like that in the last, say, 150 years. I mean, Grover Cleveland issued some good vetoes. So did Franklin Pierce. I'll say that Franklin Pierce and Andrew Johnson had some very good veto messages. So since Andrew Johnson, really 150 years ago, we haven't had any good veto messages. You know, Cleveland, I take that back. Calvin Coolidge had one very good veto message in his administration against a farm bill. But really, we've gotten to the point where veto is, if the president doesn't like the legislation, they start whipping out the veto pen. And that's not the way the veto was designed. It's not designed to be a partisan legislative tool. And the founders even said they didn't want it to be used that way when they were debating the Constitution. So John Tyler is using the veto properly. And yet, he's going to get booted from the party. The cabinet will resign. And they start impeachment proceedings, or at least the legislation is proposed by John Minor Botts. He also vetoes an internal improvements bill, which, if you look at the veto language, again, beautiful. This is what he said. At the adoption of the Constitution, each state was possessed of a separate and independent sovereignty and an exclusive jurisdiction over all streams and water courses within its territorial limits. The Articles of Confederation in no way affected this authority or jurisdiction, and the present Constitution, adopted for the purpose of correcting the defense which existed in the original Articles, expressly reserves to the states all powers not delegated. No such surrender of jurisdiction is made by the states of this government by any express grant, and if it is possessed, it will be deduced from the clause in the Constitution which invests Congress with authority to make all laws which are necessary and proper for carrying into execution the granted powers. So he's saying that you can't expand that clause, the necessary and proper clause, which has recently been called you can do anything you want to do clause. He's saying you can't do that. So John Tyler in this particular magazine, you know, the American presidents, the greatest then the worst, all the presidents ranked. Of course, John Tyler's in the back. And I'll probably talk about some of these other people. I've already mentioned Johnson. Maybe I'll do Pierce one day. And some of them they got right. You know, for example, Richard Nixon and George W. Bush, they're right. Zachary Taylor's in the bottom, and again, wrong. You know, so you can look at this and say, you know, of course, this magazine is typical. And at the beginning, obviously, you've got Abraham Lincoln and Franklin Roosevelt, who maybe I'll go over them one day and talk about how bad they actually were. But this is John Tyler. I mean, I think that John Tyler, more than anyone else in American history, needs a character resuscitation. You know, we need to look at his administration and say, you know what, this is what we expect out of the president. We shouldn't want somebody who's going to go in and legislate from the Oval Office. And I pointed this out in the video number, podcast one and two. You know, when Donald Trump says he'll look into something, he's not making policy declarations. That should be very refreshing. In contrast, Ted Cruz has a 1,050-point step-by-step process by which he's going to legislate from the executive branch. That's not what we want. You don't want anyone to do that. And so by accepting that, even from somebody who's supposedly a constitutionalist, we're violating that original constitution. And if we're going to be principled, as John Tyler was, if we're going to be principled, then you need to oppose people on both the left, which is easy to do, Clinton and Sanders. I mean, they would be a disaster. But you also need to oppose the people who would legislate from the executive branch, even on the right or libertarians or whatever whoever you're going to look at. You need to oppose those people because that's not how the executive branch was designed. The president was not supposed to wade down into the legislative arena, roll his sleeves up, and get to work. The president was supposed to sign legislation that Congress passed as long as it wasn't unconstitutional. Now, I could make a case that anyone who assumes office in 2017 should be vetoing just about everything the Congress sends him because, or her, that would be a disaster, because it's all going to be unconstitutional. Unless every bill is, we repeal this, we repeal that, we repeal this, that would be good legislation design. But not what I think they're going to get. So when people ask you who's the greatest president in American history, tell them with a straight face and a big smile, John Tyler, and see the reaction. It's well worth it. People are shocked when I say it because you're not elevating the sacred cows in American history. And if you want more of that, again, go to learntruehistory.com or look up 10 worst and 10 best presidents, Tom Woods, and the class should come up for free right now, for free. And you use that keyword executive. So head on out there and get that. I'll see you next time on The Brion McClanahan Show.